Continuing on. So far all we've done is we've asked the user for the name of the file that they want to print backwards. And then we've built the file object, and we've attached the scanner to that file object. So now we're ready to read in. So now we can loop through the file and add one word at a time to the array. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. We're going to loop through the file and add one word at a time to our array that we've built called words. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, in order to loop through, remember, we can use a while loop, and we can say while there's another word to read in. Okay, so we look at the file in, which is the scanner attached to the file, and we say, is there a word? Has next. While there is a word to be read in, then what do we want to do? Well, we want to read it in. Where do we want to read it in to? Okay, well, we want to read it into the next position in the array. And so the way that we do that with an array list is we say, go out to the words array and add. And what are we going to add? Well, we're going to add the next word. So we're going to go to the file in and get the next. Okay? And so we're going to add that. Okay? Just to make sure that this works, let's go ahead and print out the array after we're done. So I'm going to print words, and with an array list, it will print out what's in there. And so let's run this program. Now it's going to ask for the name of the file that I want to print backwards, and I can go back and use that blah.txt file that's located in this same folder, or I can type in the whole extension. I'll have to do the same thing with a backslash. So C colon backslash backslash examples backslash backslash blah.txt. Okay, so we've still got that text from the Gettysburg Address in there, and notice that one word at a time, it was print it out into this array all the way to the end. Okay? Now it's doing this thing with a double quote, and we'd have to pull up our window. Let's see if I still have it open. I do. It's a little bit strange that it's adding that double quote for the it's not a double quote, sorry. What it is the array, the way it prints is each word is separated by a comma. And I said double quote, I meant double comma. Wow, I'm telling you. I mean, I've stood on the equator. It's hot in here. So double comma comes from the fact that one comma actually goes with the word. The other comma is separating out the words in this array. Okay, I feel better. So we're going to print the Gettysburg Address backwards. This is exactly what I'm sure Abraham Lincoln wanted to do. I bet you he sat there and thought, if I could only print this thing out backwards, that would really be something. So rather than printing out the words that way, I want to print them out to a file backwards. Okay? So now that I have the words in the array, I want to print the words backwards to the output file. Okay, now what is the output file? I haven't built it yet, so let's go back up to the top, and I want to build print writer file out, I'll call it, I've called it file out twice now, but that's just because it's logically makes sense. I can call it whatever I want to, but it's going to be a new print writer, whatever I want to, given the restrictions of what you can actually name stuff. Can't start with a number and all that stuff. Can't have spaces, but other than that, I can call it whatever I want to. So what's the file I want to print out to? Well, I could ask them for the file name, but I'll just print one, C colon backslash backslash examples backslash backslash, and then I'll just call it, should I use my favorite one, output.txt? I'll call it backwards.txt. Okay, So that's the print writer is now attached to the backwards.txt. So one at a time, what I'm going to do is, so first of all, how many times am I going to do this? Well, it's going to be one time per word. And do I know at this point how many words are in there? Well, yeah, I do, because they're in the array, and I have a size property in the array that'll tell me how big it is. So I'll go 4, an int I equals 0 to begin with, and we're going to go, well, I is less than the words, I believe it's dot size, and each time we're going to increment, okay? Only, I just realized I've set this up starting at element 0 and going to the size of the array. Actually, I want to start at the end of the array. So let me start at the words.size, but if I start there, that's how many elements are there, and that's not the number of the element. Remember that the number of the element, let me try this and I'll show you what I'm talking about. And we're going to go while I is greater than or equal to 0, and then we'll decrement I each time instead. So we're going to start at the end and work our way back to element 0. If I compile and run this, oh, I got to get this print writer declaration inside the try as well. So I'll put that in there. Okay, let's try that. Law.txt. Well, that's not going to do anything. I don't know what I was thinking. I just wanted to see if it would run, and it would. But when I try and access the element, because this is just a number right now, the number of words that are in there, but when I try and actually access the element, so what I'm going to do is do a, I need to print out to the file, so I'll say file out.print. I'll do a print instead of a print line so you don't get one word per line. And then I'll print words, and then I'll get element whatever I we're on. Okay, remember that's how we access the element in a, I believe. Yes, that's how we access the element in an array list. So now it should die on me. Yeah. It gets an index out of bounds exception because I tried to access element 257 or whatever it was. And it's only, oh, right here, 262, and the size is 262. Well, if we start at 0, that means the biggest element is 261. So I have to subtract 1 from that to get a good starting place. In fact, I'll leave the spaces out so it's a little more clear. So I'm going to get the size, subtract 1 from it, and that's where I'm going to start. And then I'll print that out. Now, once I'm done printing, remember, I need to close the file. Otherwise, it'll just show up blank. And after I've closed the file, then I can go look at it. So let me do this again. I'll run this and say blah.txt. And then I should have an output file here. Okay, so there's backwards.txt. I double click on it. And it starts out with earth, and then goes to the, and then from, and then perish. And so it's gone in and let's pull up our Gettysburg address. So there's earth, the, from, perish. So it went in and did print them backwards. We started with the last element, printed that, went to the second to the last, all the way up to our 4 from 4 score and 7 years ago. Now, what we probably ought to do is put a space in between each word to make it more readable. And so after I print the word, I could print that and then a space, which would put one extra space at the end, but I could use an if statement to figure out for the last one. So I'll do this again, blah.txt, pull up the file. Okay, now we've got spaces in between the words at least. So we finish with earth, the, from, perish, not, shall, people, and so on. And so now I've ended up printing it out backwards. And so this isn't like the most useful program in the world, and it's not even formatted nice. It'd be fun to go in and just take out all the periods and try and format it after you finish a sentence. And you could get really tricky with this, but just as a basic example, that's how we do it. That's we've gone into this file. We've built the file based on what the user entered for a file name. We've attached the scanner to it. And then we've looped through one at a time, added words to an array. And then after we've got all the words into the array, then we just start at the end of the array and then go print out the words until we print them out to the file. When we're done, we close the file, and that's the end of the program. And the point I'm trying to get across here is, for one, there's no like set way to say do the program this way. And I mean, there are some ways that are more efficient, you could argue, than others. There are ways that are more simple than others, but there isn't one right way of doing things. I just said, okay, I've got this problem that I need to solve. Here are these tools that are available to me. What's the best tool to use? Yesterday I was using a flathead screwdriver to turn a Phillips screw. Well, that's probably not the best tool to use. I could have gotten away with this using an array, but an array list happened to be the Phillips screwdriver that just fits a little bit better. And so I use that array list because I can just add on to it one at a time. I don't need to declare how big it is in the beginning, and then that becomes very easy to go in and pull the words out in the end. And so really what we're doing, as we've mentioned all along, we're putting tools in the tool belt. Every time we learn a new concept in Java, that's something we can use in the future. So when we get a little further down the road and we're trying to think of, I just did this the other day. I was trying to hook up my dryer and the vent kept getting twisted and I couldn't reach it with my arm. I had to pull it out to try and change it. And then when I pushed it back in, it'd get twisted again. And so I thought, I need something long and skinny. I mean, it's something as simple as that. What could I use that's long and skinny? And in my, as I'm going through quickly my little database in my brain of what could I use, I thought of a broom. And on the way to get the broom, I saw a little curtain rod. And the curtain rod fit the mold of what I was trying to do. So I used that curtain rod to jam it down there and kind of push on the vent to try and untwist it. And that was just a tool. I just thought of that. It was just on my own. It was very impressive that I thought to use the curtain rod. But that's the point. I can't teach anybody how to write a program. And too many times I get people that ask me, hey, well, what do I do next? Well, what do I do next? Well, what do I do next? And the problem is, I could sit there and tell you what to do next if I had all the time in the world. But I can't do that when you get out into the real world and start working. The whole thing about programming is that it is a problem-solving process. There's nobody to tell you how to do it. There's nobody that tells me how to do it when I'm writing programs. We can learn how to do things, but the when to use things is just up to ourselves as we look at the problem and say, hey, here's a problem. What tools do I have available to me to solve this problem? And then you go in and use those tools to get the job done. And that is what programming. If you just need somebody to hammer out code, that's a completely different skill than solving problems. And so we want to focus on solving problems. And the language that we use is incidental, because it'll get to a point where you know a number of languages, and that even lends itself to the problem. Which language should I use? Well, which language works best for what I'm trying to do? And so, keep that in mind. This is one way of doing it. We could have done it 10 different ways, and all of them would have worked fine and been right. Okay? All right, well, hopefully that's helpful to kind of run through an example together. And with that, I will say Spencer out.